Jesus, all our sins and griefs to bear.
So y'all gonna be saying, boy, am I ever gonna be glad when we get finished with 2 Timothy. What were we talking about in the 3rd chapter last week?
Hard times and the difficult times of people and what they analyze, like themselves.
Why are there going to be these hard times? What is he saying there in the 3rd chapter? Why are these hard times coming? Because it's going to be, what does it say that? Mark last this. It's the last days. And I'm trying to make the case, I don't know how successful I am, of course, every generation could argue the same thing. But I think that it's a pretty descriptive list of things that are going on in today's culture. I know reading Warren Wiersbe's commentary on it, he said that there are 18, I didn't take time to count it, but 18 different things that are going to be prevalent in the last days that Paul lists here. I think that some of these things have always been in human existence, but it really makes you wonder if we're not moving in the last days because we're seeing more and more of these behaviors. We looked at 4 of them last week. Mark this, there will be terrible times in the last days. People will be, first of all,
lovers of themselves.
Another, I guess, way of putting that is, I'm number one. Mm-hmm. What's the second thing?
Lovers of money.
Lovers of money. Is it a problem today?
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I could have shared it with you some other time later on in the service. But y'all have heard about the reparations that are being proposed out in California?
Yes.
Okay. That if you're African American or black.
Oh, yeah, they want to give them all that money because of ancestors being in slavery.
Yeah. They want to give them like $1 million apiece, but that's not all. In fact, they did the math on it, and it comes out to $600 billion. The annual budget of California is $300 billion, so it's twice the annual budget. And by the way, they're drowning in debt out there. They're $32 billion in the hole this year already. They had forecast $22 billion, but they're $32 billion. But you would think that, you know, these people wanting to get $1 million, I think it was $1.2 million apiece, that would be enough, but no.
No, they want more.
No. And so I kind of saved this from an article that I read. They would like it to be raised not to $1.2 million apiece, but everybody be given $5 million apiece. They also proposed the elimination of all of their credit card debt, the elimination of their car loans, the elimination of their student loans, give them a string of tax breaks, give them 250 years of special benefits, such as a guaranteed income of $97,000 a year, which will be adjusted for inflation. And they would be given the ability to buy a home for just $1.
Okay. Yeah, that sounds like a bad joke.
It does.
I mean, that's true, though.
And I'm going to say something that you're going to agree with me instantly on. Even if they got it all,
they're not going to be happy.
They would. What is the old saying? Money doesn't
buy happiness.
It has to come from within. Mm-hmm. Now it can make life a whole lot easier. But it's just, Paul is saying, Timothy, mark this, in the last days, this is what you're going to see. It's just a demand for more and more money. Lovers of themselves, lovers of money.
Boastful.
Boastful. What do you mean boastful?
Why me? There's only a few of us over here. You got more over there.
Okay. You're right. Do we run into any boastful people these days?
Yeah, you do. Everybody.
Everybody.
A lot of them.
Look what I did. All right? So that's why I say when I look down this list, and this isn't the only list. I mean, you go back to Romans chapter 1, it talks in a similar way, mm-hmm. Paul writing to the Christians in Rome. All right? But he says, not only are they going to be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boastful, they're going to be proud.
Mm-hmm.
The fifth thing that he said that they were going to be is what?
Blasphemers.
Blasphemers. Mm-hmm. That's the King James Version?
Yes.
And what does the International Version say? By the way, what does it mean to blaspheme?
Insult God.
I was going to say not accepting.
We oftentimes talk about
not accepting the Holy Spirit.
We oftentimes talk about the unpardonable sin.
Yep.
Jesus said all manner of sin will be forgiven except one, mm-hmm. which is blasphemy mm-hmm. of the Holy Spirit. It means insulting.
Mm-hmm.
Just turning your back, rejecting. And you're going to find that in these last days, there is going to be, it's called blasphemy, but it's also abusive, that you reject and turn against those that you should be basically standing up for. There's going to be more of this type of behavior. Look at the next one on the list.
I got disobedience to parents.
Boy, am I glad we haven't seen that yet.
Oh, right.
There's always been an element of that, but there is just, we've got within our church, and I don't mean to pick on her or get her into trouble. She played the offertory hymn this morning, Betty Flanagan. Betty Flanagan is now, I better not say it online, she'll kill me. But she retired a number of years ago as a teacher. Why do you think she retired as a teacher?
She couldn't put up with them kids, probably.
The kids, and then also the parents.
Definitely.
They took away the right of anybody to discipline within the school.
Mm-hmm.
And so the disobedience, I cannot tell you the number of times that I've read stories about students at schools that have attacked teachers for taking away their cell phones in classes of all things.
Mm-hmm.
But there's just a total disrespect for anybody in authority. That's one of the things that we experienced here a couple of years ago with the George Floyd riots. You know, they were attacking the police all over the place. In fact, they even had defund the police. One of the most insane things that I've ever heard in my life. If you take away any sort of police force within a country, you're going to have total chaos. But disobedience to parents, and let me just say, obedience should start to be learned in the home.
And when they're little, not wait till they're older. Start when they're
absolutely.
Young.
Absolutely. Disobedient to parents? What's the next one? Ungrateful. How grateful are we for the stuff that we have today? And you say, what do you mean? I would like to just take you back 40, 50 years ago. Almost all of us can do that. Dan was still little at the time. But 40, 50 years ago, how many families had two automobiles?
Not many.
How many families had automobiles with air conditioning? Or even homes with air conditioning? How many people had homes that were carpeted throughout? How many people had even a color television? How many of you were like we, when we did have one, we went for I guess about 3 years and we didn't have a television set. We had an old black and white with the rabbit ears.
The only
Or you went outside
and turned the aluminum foil on it. On the
and you turned the antenna outside.
I was a remote for a few years. Mm-hmm. I had to go out and turn the pole a little bit.
Okay.
Right there, hey, a little bit more. Go back a little.
Okay.
And most everyone had one TV. They didn't have TV in every room like they do now.
And I'm just saying,
didn't have these cell phones. You had the rotors and three-party line, and you had to wait your turn.
But the only reason we had that was because that was the only thing that was available. Now there's better things available. We got that too.
Which is leading me where I'm going with this conversation. And what is our attitude? Are we grateful? You would think that we would feel like...
I think everybody misuses it.
If we would have had half the things back then that we have today, we would have been ecstatic. And yet you find that in many cases, we are not grateful for what we really have and how far we've come. Even clothes. Mm-hmm. Anybody here short on clothing? How many of you can remember? I know that especially the really older generation can remember growing up that you had like a Sunday outfit. Mm-hmm. And then you had the weekday outfits. And you may not even have two different sets of shoes.
You had play clothes.
You had play clothes.
I don't have my pair of shoes.
One pair of shoes.
Went barefoot all summer and waited till fall to get your regular shoes for school.
And I'm only going through this because when I look at people these days, rather than them being content or grateful for what they do have, there is more of a spirit of ingratitude, being unappreciative of what they have already been given. Paul said that these are the things that are going to be present. Mark this, Timothy, mark this. It's going to be terrible times in the last days, and you're going to see more and more of this coming around. It says not only ungrateful, what's the last word there of the second verse?
I got unholy.
Unholy. What does it mean to be holy? Set aside for God.
Yep.
Let me ask you a question. What do people set aside for God anymore? It used to be that, and I'm not saying that we necessarily need to go back to this, but Sunday was considered
the holy day, and you better have been in church on Sunday morning and Sunday evening.
And it wasn't just being in church.
Everything was closed.
I was talking with Bessie last night, and this is to put her in an awkward position. But I said, everything going okay? Yeah, she said, I've been busy, I've been getting dinner ready for tomorrow because on Sunday, it's a day of rest. I prepare all the food that we're going to eat on Sunday. I prepare it on Saturday. And I'm not faulting you. I applaud it because in your mind a long time ago, you decided some things need to be held special.
Exactly.
And within our society today, I'm saying, making the argument, nothing's considered holy anymore. Nothing is considered sacred. Well, that's not true for all of us. But when you stop to think about how far the society has gone downhill, I've told you before, it wasn't that long ago, I told you before, one of my favorite episodes of Andy Griffith was the businessman that was traveling through Mayberry on a Sunday and his car broke down. And that guy was miserable the whole day. He wanted somebody to fix his car so he could get about his work. And the stance of the people in Mayberry was, we're sorry, sir, it's a day of rest. And the man, you know, it about drove him crazy. But I really applaud that episode. People look at it now as being kind of old-fashioned. You know what would actually do our society an awful lot? If they would follow what God said and everybody take a day off. Oh, you can't do things like that.
Yes, you can.
Any of y'all get cranky when you get tired?
Yeah.
We're living in a cranky world. think a lot of it is because nothing is considered really sacred anymore. And certainly, one of the things that's considered least sacred of all is the name of God. I am so tired of hearing people say disrespectful things about OM and, you know, using the name of Jesus Christ. Remember, holiness is something that God encourages his people. And when you go back and you read both Old Testament and New Testament, God says, you are to be holy because I am holy. We are supposed to reflect God. Looking then at the third verse. Third verse, I know there's different translations. What does the King James Version there say? Third verse, first word.
Without.
Without what?
Without natural affection.
Okay, and for you can go to Romans chapter 1 that Paul talks about these people kind of traded the natural affection of things. My translation, New International Version there, says just without love. And when I read Wiersbe's commentary on this, he said that it's really kind of without kind of a family love. The family has absolutely been decimated in recent years. The family unit has absolutely been virtually destroyed. Don't want to put this person on the spot, but I was told by somebody that's now, I'm thinking this person is around 40 years of age, and this was about 5 years ago. So I'm just giving you an age bracket of how old this person was. She said that when she went to kindergarten or first grade, she came home crying from school one day and said to her mom, said, what's wrong with our family? And mom says, what do you mean, what's wrong with our family? She says, our family is not like all the other families in my class. She said, what do you mean your family's not like all the other families in its class? She said, all the other kids have moms and dads that have been divorced, and our family hasn't. And I know you sit there, but she was being totally honest. And this was from somebody that's right around 40 years of age now, if not a little bit older than 40. And Paul said in the last days, you're going to see this kind of disintegration of natural love. It's not just going to be natural love of men toward women. It's going to be natural love of family units. You know, the attitude used to be, you pick on your, on me, you're going to deal with the whole family. What else did he say is going to go on in the third verse?
Unforgiving.
Somebody give me a simple definition of forgiving. When you see the word forgiving. What are you for, Sherry? What are you in favor of? Taking or giving?
Giving.
You are for giving?
Yes. Sometimes it's hard.
Okay.
It took me a while.
And I'm using that.
To forgive this person that I, and they're not the ones hurting, it's you. They don't even know maybe you're having problems with them. And they don't care.
It is. I was trying to do a little play on words because oftentimes we think about forgiving, forgive and forget, so on and so forth. But I'm trying to emphasize that the Bible says that what marks Christians is that they are in favor of, they are for giving.
Yeah.
As opposed to many people that, what can I get? Paul says you're going to see more and more of this unforgiving spirit. I'm going to take you here in just a minute to another passage of scripture over in the book of Revelation. But look at what it says in the rest of the third verse. Not only without love, unforgiving. Next.
Slander, right there.
Slander.
False accusers.
Yeah, slanders.
False accusers. Saying stuff that you know just really is not true. Mm-hmm. Slander the person, run the person down. What was the old saying that your mom used to tell you?
Bang it up.
Don't have something good to say, don't say anything at all. You're going to be, people are going to be slanderous. What's the next one? Oh boy, we don't have any problem with that within our society. What's the next one say?
Without self-control.
Everybody's completely under control, aren't they?
Oh yes, definitely.
Oh yeah. Yeah. What's the toughest thing for you to control?
Mine was my temper years ago.
Okay.
And I used to have to pray and ask God to take that away from me because I tell everybody I'm not a redhead for no reason. I snap right down.
Okay.
I'd gonna punch you and ask questions later. That's
okay.
Just was my attitude.
What are people showing, what other things are people showing a lack of self-control in?
Their tongue.
Their tongue, what they say.
Yes.
Are people
Words
doing well?
Words can hurt you.
Are people doing well with their finances? No.
No.
You are aware. You are aware that credit card debt is the highest that it's ever been?
Oh yeah.
It's over $1 trillion worth of credit card debt. How about our health? Do we have our health issues under control? Yeah, the Bible doesn't say just one specific area. It just says that people are just going to be kind of out of control in the last days. They're just not going to have the ability to control itself. And I'll tell you, the strength to control yourself, and you said it in the first thing that you spoke out about, you pray to the Lord to help you.
Yeah, because I would have probably, I'm telling you, I was...
Little Allie that was here at the church this morning, back there in Jonah's church, they made plates on paper plates, and they colored them with magic markers, and they put a scripture verse on it. The scripture verse that she put on mine was one of the ones that I quoted in the morning message. Philippians 4:13. I can do all things through
Christ who strengthens me.
That's where the source of our self-control comes from. Is it doesn't come from inside of us, it comes from outside of us. If God pours it into us, we need God's help to get ourselves under control. It said not only are they going to be without self-control, they're going to be, what's the next word? My translation says, what did yours say?
Fierce?
Mine says brutal.
Brutal. Just absolutely, it's almost like they enjoy the sort of gore and the sort of stuff that's going on. There's going to be more of this. We're going to hopefully get through this. Not lovers of the good. One of the things that bothers me the most about what we're seeing these days is the fact Isaiah wrote about it in Isaiah chapter 5 in the last days, that good would be called evil. Evil would be called
all good.
These days, you're condemned if you say anything about the whole transgender thing.
Yes, you're in trouble.
You mean to tell me, and we could get banned on YouTube for this, you really mean to tell me that it's good to take somebody that's, you know, like a little boy, and you want to transition him over to a girl? And you go in before this kid has maybe even reached puberty because they're asking to do this on kids that are like 8 years of age. And by the way, recently Washington State has declared itself to be a sanctuary state, which means that if the kids will make it there, the state will take control of the kids and prevent the kid from being stopped by the parents. They've actually taken away parental control. And then they will take that kid that's not really old enough to make, let's face it, folks, you're still not in most states even supposed to give kids tattoos before the age of 18.
21 in some states.
21, you know more about it than I do. But to take and do a life-altering surgery on a kid at that age, just the kid thinks that it's going to be something novel, sort of. Can you imagine what they've done, the way that they've mutilated that child? And once that's done,
there's no turning back.
There's no turning back. I mean, you can do surgeries, kind of reverse it, but you're going to create all sorts of problems. You really think that's good? You really think, and I keep looking at the camera, do you really think that that kid, even though they were born one gender, that they're not going to be ridiculed by people in the days ahead? Do you really think that everybody's just going to say, oh, I guess you are? No, there's going to be all sorts of ridicule. And it's been shown that these people that go through it, they have a terrible time trying to adjust to it. The whole transgender thing is not something that's good. It is absolutely evil. I just read an article, I think it was yesterday or early this morning, that 71% of the men whose, you know, girlfriend or whatever had an abortion, 71% of the men were greatly affected psychologically by the death of that child that they had fathered. They had a hard time coping with the fact that that child that they had sired, that they had helped create, was exterminated. You know, they oftentimes will lead women to believe it's just a blob of tissue. No, it's not. And they know that it's not. And we're seeing within our society so many times things that should be labeled as evil, they're being called good. The Democrat Party, a lot of people say don't get political, but I'm telling you right now, the Democrat Party is in favor of abortion clear up until the time of birth. And anybody that supports that, I'm telling you right now, you've got problems with God. God says that's flat out murder. How in the world can you vote for that? It's an abomination before God. Don't expect God to be pleased with that. People are not going to be lovers of the good. Instead, they're going to embrace more and more evil sort of stuff. And our society is just absolutely being overrun with evil. It says not only lovers of the good, it says to the fourth verse, King James Version says what? Treasonous?
Traitors.
Traitors.
Yep.
Mine says treacherous.
Mine says despisers of good.
Okay.
That's a new King James.
Okay. Looking out for whatever they do. I know that our time's running out. We're not going to get through the whole thing tonight because I'm going to have to probably start next week in that fourth verse, treacherous. But the other passage of Scripture that I wanted to turn with me to look at tonight, Revelation chapter 16. Because this is a real picture of the last days. And I know that it raises the question, are you talking about pre-tribulation rapture, mid-tribulation rapture, or post-tribulation rapture? Meaning you believe that Jesus is going to come before the tribulation, partway through the tribulation, or after the tribulation. This is obviously what's taking place in the tribulation. But this just, it just really to me kind of stands out. Because the 16th chapter of Revelation talks about the bowl judgments. There are three different judgments that are talked about in the book of Revelation. This is the last one, the bowl judgments. And it said, I'll skip through the first part of it, but I'm going to start the first verse. It said, then I heard a loud voice from the temple saying to the seven angels, go pour out the seven bowls of God's wrath on the earth. And what I want you to focus on is these things were poured out, rather than people's hearts being turned back to God, their hearts are turned further and further away from God. And you won't read it here in these first verses that I'm going to read, but as we go down through it, you're going to see it. Look at the second verse. The first angel went and poured out his bowl on the land, and ugly, painful sores broke out on the people who had the mark of the beast and worshipped his image. And it says, the second angel poured out his bowl on the sea, and it turned into blood like that of a dead man. And every living thing in the sea died. It hasn't put anything in there yet about people's response. It says, fourth verse, the third angel poured out his bowl on the rivers and springs of water, and they became blood. So this is rivers, springs of water. And then I heard an angel in charge of water say, you are just in these judgments. You you who are and who were the Holy One, because you have so judged. For they, all these people, have shed the blood of your saints and prophets, and you have given them blood to drink as they deserve. And I heard the elder respond, yes, Lord God Almighty, true and just are your judgments. So then you move to the eighth verse. The fourth angel poured out his bowl on the sun, and the sun was given power to scorch people with fire. They were seared by the intense heat. And rather than turning to God, what did they do? They cursed the name of God who had control over these plagues. But they refused to repent and glorify him. So the fifth angel poured out his bowl on the throne of the beast, and his kingdom was plunged into darkness. Men gnawed their tongues in agony and cursed the God of heaven because of their pains and their sores, but they refused to repent of what they had done. So the sixth angel poured out his bowl on the great river Euphrates, and its waters were dried up to prepare the way for the kings from the east. Then I saw three evil spirits that looked like frogs. They came out of the mouth of the dragon, out of the mouth of the beast, and out of the mouth of the false prophet. They are spirits of demons, performing miraculous signs, and they go out to the kings of the whole world to gather them for battle on the great day of God Almighty. And then Jesus speaks here. Behold, I come like a thief. Blessed is he who stays with him and keeps his clothes with him, so that he may not go naked and be shamefully exposed. Then they gather the kings together to the place that in Hebrew is called Armageddon. And it said, the seventh angel poured out his bowl into the air, and out of the temple came a loud voice from the throne saying, it is done. Then there came flashes of lightning, rumblings, peals of thunder, and a severe earthquake. No earthquake like it has ever occurred since man has been on earth. So tremendous was the quake. The great city split into three parts, and the cities of the nations collapsed. God remembered Babylon the Great and gave her the cup filled with the wine of the fury of his wrath. Every island fled away, and mountains could not be found. From the sky, huge hailstones of about 100 pounds each fell upon men. And so what did people do?
Still curse God. I mean, didn't they get it, you know? How stupid can you be?
And I'm drawing, and people say, well, you know, this is during the tribulation. There are those that believe the church is going to be out here before this tribulation. And I'm just saying that whether this is something different than what Paul is writing about, if the tribulation happens about different than the last times, that, or if it's part of it, rather than you see people having their hearts turned back to God, people are going to turn further and further away from God. The further and further they turn away from God, the more evil they are going to become. And that's one of the things that just concerns me about the direction that things are going. I do get encouragement from time to time. I see some things that are taking place. There's states out there that are trying to pass bans on abortion. Very grateful to that. There are a lot of states out there right now that are trying to prevent all of this mutilation of children through the transgender movement. I'm grateful for that. But Paul is trying to say to Timothy, when you begin to see these things, these are warnings. Mark this. And Jesus said, when you go back to Matthew chapter 24, you need to start paying attention to the signs. He says, when you start to see these things, know that the end is near. Do I believe that we're moving into the end times? Yeah, I do. I won't get into it because we don't have time to talk about it, but if you go back to Revelation chapter 13, where it talks about the mark of the beast, it said that people are going to have to receive the mark of the beast in order to basically buy or sell. And I don't like some of the things that I see going on within our country with all of the marking of people. So when you say, what do you say we do about it, Pastor Tim? Make sure that when you read the Word of God, that you're not doing the things that he describes there. For all the bad things that he has, there's an opposite of a good thing that he wants you to do. And we have to work at it. We have to work at, I'll use as an example, making sure that we don't allow everything within our lives to become unholy. You know, even if it's a simple thing like, you know, a lot of people don't even take time to give thanks to God for the food that they eat. It gives us an opportunity to bow our heads and recognize, God, I thank you for this food. But as you go through that list, just understand that Paul is saying, when you begin to see a real increase of all of this stuff, I'm telling you, Timothy, look up, for your redemption draws nigh. We did not finish going through the rest of that list, 18 different words that Paul uses there. And I do believe that we're seeing all of those things today. So do you have any comments or questions that you'd like to make? No? Okay. You are still awake? Put my glasses on. See if I see the whites of your eyes. Okay. Well, let's pray together. Father, we've tried to go through some more of this list that Paul said to Timothy. He told Timothy, kind of keep your eye open for this sort of stuff, because this is going to mark the beginning of the end. And Father, I personally feel like that we're getting close to the end. I think that Paul felt that way back in his day, and that was 2,000 years ago. It may not be, but we do know that it is going to get worse. And as we read, whether you take your church out of here prior to the tribulation or if the church goes to the tribulation, there will be a time on this earth that it's going to be just horrendous. A lot of it's going to be your judgment, but the response of people to things will not be to turn back towards you. It will be to curse you. And I pray, Father, that you might help us to be faithful, to try to do what your word tells us to do, and to try to honor you and to make you proud. We just pray, Father, your blessing upon this study, to our, bless the study to our lives and us to your service. We pray that you'll dismiss us with your blessing, that you'll keep us safe, and that you'll bring us back the next appointed time. But until then, we pray that you might use us for your glory. Thank you for being our God. Thank you for the time that you've given us together. Keep us in your care. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen.